Ben's room. I'm Onimisi Adaba, and tonight I have who I'll call the unusual suspects with me. We're just going to talk a whole lot, a conversation in the trail of which we have been with RMD, with IK, and these guys are in. Okay, I wouldn't let you in on who they are. We'll just take a quick break, and when I come back, I'll let you in on who my unusual suspects are. It's the men's room. Stay with us. Welcome back. If you're just hooking up, right on time. And thank you for hooking up. I'm Onimisi Adaba, and this is the men's room. Tonight, I have me, my friends, my colleagues, professionals in the industry. They have their stories to share. These are guys that you just call them up short notice and boom, they're here. And that's exactly what happened. And we're just going to have a conversation with these guys fundamentally to learn a thing or two, to hear their story. We've always known them in the limelight doing one thing or the other, but there's a back end to it. There's a behind the scenes to it from which we can learn and just look at them from a different perspective. So who goes first? I have, how many people know Stephen Ono? Okay, so how many people know your? Exactly. So I have your in the house, and then you should know Emmanuel Essien, right? Okay, Manny. Uh-huh. All right, so we have your and Manny in the house, my friends, my colleagues. Thank you for coming, guys.
Yes, boss. The boss.
Actually, for two of you, this is the second time in the men's room, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
But not with the Manny the first time.
Yes, I mean separately, yeah. Separately. Of course. All right, good to have you guys in. So like I did say, it's just a conversation we're going to have, just to talk us through some elements of your life, in a bit to reach out to folks who want to be like you or trying to make their marks in their own capacities and all of that, and losing steam and losing hope and all of that. And so we'll talk on a whole lot of other things. So you guys have been in the limelight for as long as whenever people know you, left, right, and center. Has it always been like this?
Always in the limelight, you said. No, I guess we had to walk through the ropes. We've been at our trade for a very long time, off the radio, before radio, and after radio. I would like to say that for me, particularly, you know, I am more interested in the journey than the destination, you know.
That is powerful, because in the journey, you can enjoy the journey before getting into the destination.
Yes.
There's every likelihood of folks losing a whole lot of steam in the journey, hoping to get to the destination and not getting there.
Yes, because in this business, if you think that you are at your destination already, then... that's when you begin to decline. So you always have to believe that you are still traveling, you know. So for me, I think in my career, from production to radio, still in production, you know, I have always seen it as a journey, you know. And I have never for once ever believed that I've gotten to my destination. I think that has been my guide for me. You know, I've always been traveling and I'm still traveling. So I think in this profession for me, it has been my call card. Every now and then, when I think that maybe
I hear the continuous perfection of your craft. That's what I hear.
Yes, you have to, I believe so. You have to continue, you know, redefining yourself because there is no end to it, to this business.
Okay, Yo, how about you?
I know I'm not where I used to be.
Definitely.
But definitely, I'm not where I want to be. And I know that playing is my job. But I don't play with my job, and that's just the truth.
That's a play on words.
Yes.
Playing is your job, but you don't play with your, job.
I don't play with my job.
Fantastic. And you know, it's so easy to play with the job because of what it is.
Yes.
It's entertainment, it's laughter, it's fun, it's entertainment. And so it's so easy to get lost.
To get carried away, yes. And then you forget the
majority. How do you stay focused?
Man, when you think of the bills that you have to pay, you'll definitely be focused. When you think, you know, I'm not like them guys that club party, SAG, and all that. But a comedian once said to me, a man I respect so much, Ali Baba, he would always say, money where Pekin, money where young boys take, they buy jeans and drink. Now, in man, we get family, big they take care of in children, we they think of in family. So when you think of the bills that you have to pay, you have no option but to stay focused and then chase what it is that you're chasing, and so that everyone will be happy. So it's not easy though, but hey, we're there.
Okay, so how do you balance all of these things with family? Again, still keeping you guys in the limelight. I'm saying that because you're either in the studio or anchoring events or acting or in production, singing or producing beats and all of that. So how do you balance this with family?
For me, 24 hours is not enough, really. But then, you have to learn to manage time. They say no time in Freetown. Nothing is free in Freetown. So if you allow those times to go, if it goes, it's never coming back. So you must use it well. Every minute, every second. Even when I'm on leave, I'm just on leave from radio, not on leave from every other thing. So I'm still thinking, I'm still writing down, I'm still jotting down ideas.
And family?
Family, of course, everything together. You know, trying to jot things down and trying to make things work. But it's not easy. 24 hours is not enough, but you must learn to manage it. That's it for me.
Well, you have said it all, but for me, I also want to just also say that I would like to believe that family has given birth to a structure, because you know, I don't want to imagine what my life would be like as a single person. I'm 40 years old. I don't want to imagine that I would have been single till this time, because I would like to say that the family has given me a structure to whatever I do. You know, therefore I find myself going back to something that has a structure. So it guides my finances. It guides my outgoing, like you said. You know, I learned something from someone who a prominent figure as well, who told me that sometimes, you know, not being seen has its price, positive and negative as well. So if you're always seen at all, you're as a walk about and knock about, your value might depreciate or it could appreciate depending on how you see it. And therefore, for him, he was always seen where he's relevant. So
kind of like picking your battles,
picking where you want to be, and letting them know that if they see you somewhere, it means you're part of something, or you're behind the background, like for example, y'all could be behind the cameras producing a program. He could be on stage, so he's being relevant at a function, not just going there to just go and, you know, spend $150 on a dress and come home and sit down when you have bills to pay. So it's creating that relevance for yourself makes you a proper man, you know. And then also, I think friends, the kinds of friends you pick as you on your way up as well, can influence your pattern in life.
And the ones you drop.
Sadly, you know.
Even if you're not dropping, things just have a way of weeding things out. The profession, the stage in your life. Circumstances just have a way of weeding out, not sometimes you do it consciously as in, hey, look, I'm cutting loose from this person, but other times it is just nicely done by the turn of events, wouldn't you say?
It's nice you brought up this topic, because it's a very interesting topic, because there are friends you meet at the beginning of your life.
There we go.
There are friends who overtake you in the course of your life,
and they
don't affiliate with you anymore. But because of your consistency in your art, you get to just climb up to a point where you meet them again. You meet them again, and it's almost like it's like a revelation, you know, to the person who obviously didn't regard you. I don't know whether y'all can.
Yes, it's you said it. Yes. Definitely, it's not those that you start primary school with that you're with till date. Secondary school, university,
and for some, it's as if there was a fight.
No fight. And you know, it's so funny when some of them now call you and then they say to you, "Now, wow, you just forget us," as if we were real buddies before, you know. Or and then you just ask them.
See that a lot on Facebook.
Yes, of course. And then they now say to you, and then I say to them, "Nobody say you get my number before now." We're not a talk before. So what is hey, you don't forget also. You don't remember me too. I don't remember you. I'm sure you called me for a reason. So just go ahead and hit it, you know. So, but we just have to learn to just move with the times. My mom will always say, she will say it in Igbo. You look for a black goat in the morning, not when your mates have finished what they want to do from morning to night. In the night, and that's when you will now start when time don't pass. Have to start early.
Start early.
Move with the time. Move. That's just the best thing.
Talking about moms, what was it like growing up for you?
My mama did slap for a living. She's a slappist. My mom will slap to reset your brain.
That's what it's called, the reset.
Yes, my mom can slap. It was that bad because in Igbo it will be said that Nga Magiola. Magiola means if I slap you. So Maggie, we used to call my mother Matthew, that she can slap, that she became Matthew. You know, I grew up like that. You know, not nowadays again when kids don't understand sign language. I grew up with sign language.
Yes.
My mom will only just look at you and you understand perfectly well what she's talking about.
Facial expression.
Oh, speaks. God.
Yeah.
You cannot move, you know. And then, you know, but now things have changed.
But
things
how did changed. That form you?
Yes, I mean, exactly.
You, your mom, you've spoken glowingly about her.
Yeah.
As a slappist. Your father wasn't there?
No, my dad was, but my dad is this quiet kind of guy.
Mm.
If you do anything to my dad will wait for my mom to come back and then he will raise up the topic.
And then
he's always having toothpicks in his mouth. Earlier today, you came to meet me and then you said, my mom will now say, what happened? Toza. Immediately. My dad was a calm guy, but it was my mom.
Yeah.
If I tell my dad, I've got headache, I can't do this. My dad said, no, go and rest. If you tell my mom, I've got headache, I can't. Go and do it. The people that are doing it are not dying. Go and be. Die first. Then I'll see that you have died. That's the way I grew up. Yeah. And then we were 8 at home. We were 10 kids. We were 8 at home. So it wasn't easy. My mom didn't take it lightly with me in particular.
She didn't spare the rod with you.
Yeah, she didn't. Ah. Ross, you don't even need to know.
I'll come to some other angle. Manny, how about you? How was growing up?
Wow. Your
family, were you guys closely knit? Were you...
I thank God for where I came from. Because, Uji, I won't lie to you, man. I'm so grateful for where I came from.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I look at where my father came from, you know, those days, you know, it's not like today. Those days, your parents borrowed money from villages.
Mm-hmm.
To go to school.
Parents
borrow money from, you know, communities in their villages. I bet when I train this one, or more donate money.
Yeah,
that is how my father went to school.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he was one of, like, yours family, like 15 boys. You know, they were just dying anyhow. Die. And when he went overseas, you know, my father was an associate professor, University of Oxford.
Mm. Wow.
Yes, my father had majored in chemistry, physics. So now, buku person.
Mm.
So when he came back to Nigeria, you know, you can imagine having a son who wants to go into music. You know, it's just a misfire. It's just so
a misfortune.
It's just it's
waste of money.
In fact, if my father is eating and it looks at me, he can look at me like, poor you, like,
what a pity.
You know, like, where
he looks at you with sympathy.
Yeah, you know, that kind of thing. And I used to stammer, you know, so you can imagine he's asking me a question and I'm like, that is it. Oh, please just go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it was, so that's, so for me it was like, how can I impress this man? How can I live up to this man's expectations?
Yeah.
Because the standard was too high.
Mm-hmm.
It was just too high. And it followed in everything that he did. The kinds of clothes he bought, the kinds of films he bought. My father would travel and go and buy, I mean, the very best of musicals, Mary Poppins, Sound of Music, My Fair Lady. So my mind was influenced by all those kinds of musicals. I thought it was a negative one, but after a while I began to write.
He was equipping you without knowing.
Before I knew I started writing rhymes. I started busting 16. I was, you know, because of the influence.
Mm.
You know, you can imagine. I mean, a boy growing up in that kind of environment from age 7. So I began to see the benefits of that, my dad.
Mm.
So many years later, I began to see that if not for all those films, if not for the exposure that my father gave me, I don't think I don't think I'll be who I am.
And your mom?
Mumsy was
unlike quiet, unlike type. Yours, mom.
Very opposite of yours. Very, very opposite.
Yeah.
Mumsy cannot hurt a fly.
Mm.
You know,
actually, which, like my mom too.
You know,
she was my mom was the.
My mom cannot hurt a fly.
You guys, I love you. My father was the.
Till today, you know, in fact, that term, mommy's boy, you know, it doesn't come out for nothing.
Are you the last?
I'm the last boy now.
Oh, no wonder.
Last boy. Oh, you're
it's usually like that. Yes, no wonder.
Number seven. That's my number. Seven is a number. Yes, it's a special number.
it's the number of completion.
I know.
You completed the matter.
I completed it, but now we still went ahead for 3 more. I pity them.
But my father was someone who, you know, if he's angry, you don't want to see him. Mm. You don't want to talk to him at all. Because when he flips on everybody.
Mm.
You know, and I told myself personally that I've witnessed my father's rage. You know, whenever him and my mom clashed, I witnessed the rage from age 7. So I told myself, nah. When I do get married,
you wouldn't want
to
be like
I don't want to have that rage, you know, because man, that rage. Those days, rage was okay. You know, those days, you know, you could have, you know, you could see things and it was okay. But these days, it's not okay.
Right.
Yeah, you know.
And left.
You understand? So it gave birth to a certain calmness in my spirit. I said, I don't want to be like this. I don't want to be like my dad was. Ah, the guy they flip.
How has it reflected for you in marriage?
Well, it just gave me peace, you know. Different folks with different strokes, you know, but it gave me kind of peace, you know. So, and it's been like that for me since the day I got married. So,
okay.
Yeah. So that's what I took from my dad, my mom, calmness, you know. I wish she was a bit firmer, you know. I wish I had a your kind of mom.
You lost it.
I wish I had a your kind of mom.
Don't. Even me, I don't wish to have my kind of mom. Even me. Don't.
You know, I have a friend who says her mother specialized in throwing slippers or anything nearby.
Huh.
You know, and before you know it, it's hit you and you feel like, where did this come from? You know, so it's like when you're there and you know you're on the wrong, you're watching and looking
anything that can just fly. You know, those days when my mom beats you, she'll beat you and she'll expect you not to cry. Oh, and she'll stab you, she'll say, How can you be beating me?
You know that
you don't expect me to cry.
This picture made the rounds on WhatsApp. That there's a funny dog.
Okay.
A funny expression that says this is the face you would have when your mom slaps you and says, "If I hear bim."
But it's the truth. You're not expected to say anything. Ah no.
My father beat us. And the belt cut, so he didn't have what he could use, so he used shoes. I know those shoes those days, man.
Oh no!
They are packed. The soles are packed with wood, so we had to to create some defense mechanism in our butt. So we had to put the day my dad found out that I had put something in my butt. Oh my goodness.
So butt padding didn't really start today.
Money, you can see it now. Even are you sure you're not even part of money? You're not seeing us here in the studio. Money is I suspect him.
Oh my goodness. But it was a good thing now. But yeah. I mean,
looking back, you'd say discipline worked.
Yeah, it worked. Yeah. For me, I think that is
it worked.
Yeah, that is what's keeping me till date, and then it helped to mold me. Mold me.
Okay.
Into what I am today.
Now it's the men's room right here. I'm Onimisi Adaba and hanging out with my friends, my colleagues, Yor and Manny. Just talking through life and giving you an angle of them you hardly know, you barely know. We'll take a quick break, and when we come back, I'll bring you the concluding part. Stay with us. Welcome back. It's the men's room. I'm Onimisi Adaba, and again, I'm talking with Yor and Manny, just sharing their life stories and making it relevant to where you are, what you're doing, and what you're going through right now. And just to let you in on the fact that it's all good, it's okay, you'll be fine. Now, talking about mothers, slappers, our fathers, and all of that. Now,
yeah.
In one of your interviews, you said your cousin took you to the welder's shop. to go and learn. Yeah. He refused. And he said you should go to the mechanics workshop to learn how to repair cars. And you refused. And finally he said the last help he will do for you is to learn how to fix motorcycles. That's the Okada.
Yeah.
And in his words, he says that is where your destiny lies.
Yeah.
And then you actually hawked ice water in Yaba Market.
Yeah.
And then you were a bus conductor and all of that.
Yep.
Take us through that.
Because when you decide on the path that you want to go in life and then you don't have any encouragement from anyone, my mom in particular, and they never wanted me to do anything that concerns the arts. Mm. So I also just told myself I needed to leave, I needed to survive on my own and all that. So I had a friend by name Mutiu, and every weekend he's got a bus, or he had a bus then, and every weekend, and then we ply Yanokpaja to Juelegba and all that, just to make that extra cheddar, just to keep myself afloat. And then, but the conductor, the ice water, the selling of what they call soft drinks now, mineral.
Yeah.
That's what we used to call it. I used to shout them, go to mineral at Yaba Market, you know. And then an ice water, the 1 naira one. Is it one naira? One naira.
Mm.
Is it tankable? The nylon one that they tie, I can't remember. I used to sell those at Yaba Market just to make a living, to add to whatever it is that I got from my mom and all that. So it wasn't easy at all. And then for my cousin, that was when I was still in secondary school, and then when he said to me to go learn, that he sees it that is where I will make it in life. Yeah, that's the way he said it. And then I said, okay, no problem. And then he took me to those places. And then when I turned him down, he said he wanted to help me. He has seen it, that I will make it. It was even the motorcycle repairer one that was, because he said, then there was no Okada.
Yes.
So he just said to me, learn how to fix motorcycles. Very soon there will be this boom and people will be using motorcycles for business. And you'll be a force to reckon with. Mm. People will want to come to you to fix their bikes because you already have a name. And when I said no, he said, no, you see, I want to help you, your destiny. And then you are turning it down.
You're turning it's down your destiny.
Yes, it's obvious you are useless. But hey, I say I'd rather be that thing I want to be.
Yes.
Yeah, even though that I never got the support earlier with my parents. Even getting admission into university, I did diploma in LASU 95. Yeah. I did diploma in LASU 95.
You had always seen yourself
as an entertainer, this, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So I did diploma in LASU 95, 95 session. And then when it was time for me to do direct entry to do degree, my mom sent her sister to the university and told them not to give me admission.
Why?
Yeah, because she felt that entertainers, we end up being useless. Yeah. Yeah, that's her word, her exact word. Mm. You just want to be useless. You just want to go haywire and all that. So she told them not to give me admission. And then a lecturer of mine spoke to her and said, no, it's not like that. You might be an actor and yet be working in a bank. You might do theater arts and yet be working in a bank and do other things. It's not a must that... He said, I'm a lecturer here. I also did theater arts and I'm teaching. It's not a must. You must act. If you don't want him to act, he can do other things. So my mom's sister now said, okay. She went back home and told my mom. And... But then I now started. I left my house then. I just started staying with friends and all that. And until the first day I said I was going to the UK to act Commonwealth Games.
Yes.
Commonwealth that they had in London. Mm. I think that was 99 or thereabouts. I can't remember again. 99 or 98. I can't remember. And then I told my mom. I came back home, you know, with so much pride, you know, like, oh, shame, Tona. You guys don't want me to be an actor.
Yeah.
And then I'm going, and then I came back and then I told them, yeah, I'm going to London, I'm going to act. And she was really surprised. And yeah, so you're going to act. Yeah. And then there I went and then it's okay. And then the rest is history now. The rest is history, you know. But I thank God for the journey. Thank God for where I am, thank God for the process and all. Yeah.
And looking back now, she is
I think she, yeah. She's grateful.
She's been to a couple of your
Yeah. She does. Even this year, I think she should come May 28, Eco Hotel and Suites. Mm. But then I used to tell people that it is what you make out of it that matters. Mm. I think all that is what you're seeing today. This is the end product, you know. And I think I'm just happy about it. I think for everything that we pass through in life, we should see it as a learning ground, as a learning field. Mm. When people ask me what are the challenges I faced growing up, I say I don't see challenges, I only see opportunities to get better.
Perspective.
Yes, and that's exactly what happened to me. I just saw it and then I grabbed it and then I overcame and then here I am today.
So Mani, you had your own rough times of eventually beginning to rent apartments and your landlord listened to you playing, you know, your beats and all of that, and he turns out to be in the what do you call it now, he heard you making jingles and it turned out he was in the advertising industry and he drew your attention, did something for him, and that marked your change. Talk us through that.
Yes, for me, I never imagined that I would work in advertising or I'll be a freelance producer. I never imagined any of those things in my life. Like you rightfully put, that's why I just believe that, you know, I think it's about the consistency of the drive to keep doing whatever you want to do in your life. For me, trying so many years to break it out as a musician, you know, I was hitting a brick wall continuously, going from one competition to the other. I went from Golden Tones to Benson and Hedges. I went to Rothman's Groove. I went everywhere. I won some, didn't win some. I kept going up and down, trying to go to different competitions just to show myself. Then one day, I just realized that, come on, let me just try other things. You know, let me just try other things like writing jingles.
You are like a hustler.
I had no idea that I would sell any of them. You know, I went to a place called Heavy Metal Studios in Suri Lere. Then it was run by a very famous engineer called Johnson, who gave me my first break with some of my production credits, because I stumbled there by accident. I was making a jingle for a man called he was on a TV show, Bastian Company. Albert Egbe. So someone led me to him, and he said he wanted to produce something like a short ad. So I did something for him. He said, "Oh, hold on, I like it. Please come to the studio." That's how I found my way to Heavy Metals. When I got there, Johnson came into the studio, saw me walking. So what happened was, I was introduced to something that I did not expect. You get? It's because of the desire to just keep, stay in the music zone, stay in the music realm, just stay in there. Then, you know the funny thing is, I did not like the job. I hated producing adverts or jingles. I hated it. Because I get $1K, $2K, how can I survive? You know? So I was in the apartment, like you said, I was in the BQ, just playing something for MTN, just playing in my head, just playing around with it. The man that owns the building is an advertiser. And he comes in the backyard to drink and chat and everything. So that odd day, like you said, very odd day, he was just behind my door, chilling out with his friends, drinking, and he heard me playing, chanting. And he just came inside and said, "Come, what are you doing here?" I said, "Is this yours?" "Yes." He said, "Play it again." And I played it for him. He said, "Wow. You did this?" I said, "Yes." He says, "Do you know what this is?" I said, "Well, in my mind, I'm thinking 2K, 3K, you know." So, you know, but because he just said, "You need to send this to somebody else and let me know what happens. But it's worth it." I didn't know what he was talking about. He gave me an ID card. A complimentary card. And you know me now, this Calabar boy in me, you know, packaging, you know, we didn't know how to package. So I will carry the keyboard on Okada through the whole process, thinking that this is how it's supposed to be. And he was sending me to a pitch where people were sitting down making presentations.
Packaged people
with laptop, everything. And here is this guy coming in from rain with keyboard on his lap. I was sweaty. I was not a good sight at all. I wasn't even looking at that.
And your dreadlocks had started falling.
I had dreads.
So it was like,
I was a Rasta movement.
Dreadlocks
so,
beaten by
so
the rain.
So it doesn't look good. So here I am now. And this guy obviously owes my landlord a favor.
Yeah.
So when he picked the call and said, you're from so person, Uncle Dave, I said, yes, okay, come inside. You're late for the pitch. I said, pitch? Well, what is pitch? I've never heard the word pitch before. So I entered I saw people, round table, big people. And he says, gentlemen, please, we don't have much time. Let's hear what you have. So here I am now. I just plug my keyboard and I hear people laughing. People are just, giggling. I'm like, what's going on? Is this a comedy show? And I plug my keyboard and I put it on and I start playing along with the jingle that I have created for the brand.
Mm-hmm.
And halfway through the jingle, the guy stands up and just starts clapping and says, please, this is the best thing he has heard since they started this pitch. Mm-hmm. Can we please close the pitch? Young man, please sit down over there.
Just like that.
And he walked out.
Just like that.
I had no idea what he was talking about. But all I know is that some other guy comes to me and says, bruv, please, can you fill this form here, write this here, write that there. They now advanced me with the 100,000 naira.
From PK.
From 2,000 naira. I don't know what is that. I don't even know what is happening. The next thing I see Jai Abudari coming in and says, dude, keep it up. Good job. I say, Then I now have to understand that that 100,000 naira, they now give me a professional brief. Because you can do this, that means you can do
more.
This. And they said, we want a theme song for Abuja 2003 games. And they want it in 30 seconds.
Mm.
I said, hey, what is a brief? So people, nobody wants to help you. Yeah, go and do your job. So here I go again. I carry my keyboard. I go to Heavy Metal Studio.
So by and large,
it began a process.
Yeah, that started the process.
It began a process. I had no idea that because of my, I don't know. See, just being inquisitive in life can pay you off. Because I did not want to do this. I wanted to just be a musician.
You know, I was going to ask, if you were not doing this, what would you be doing?
I would be a junkie. I'll be first class junkie, man. I'll be up and down studios. But I saw a life, not until my account, I got alert.
Mm.
When the alert started coming,
you changed the
my mother called me on the phone and asked me, what are you doing in this Lagos? You said you have rented a house. Did you steal? Because I know you read linguistics. There's no, what are you doing in that Lagos? I said, I'm working. He said, doing what? I said, I'm making jingles. What is jingles? How do you do that? It was a long process for me, but trust me, I can't count the number of jingles I made from there, paid my house rent, bought my first car. I can't count the process. Bills,
school fees.
In fact, I didn't even want to work in a radio station.
Hmm.
I didn't want to work. It was Olisa who said, look, dude, this is your voice, cannot waste. So I started seeing things I never saw. So I think if you sit down in your life and just rely on one channel, you will starve.
All right, thanks.
You don't stand in one place to watch the masquerade.
Hmm.
So if change position. Yes, if masquerade moves like this, you move. If it moves, you move.
Steal that from you?
No, carry on.
So in all of this, now, where does how does faith play with you guys?
Which of the faith?
I don't know. Whatever faith.
F-A-I-T-H. In God or in man or in anything you do.
I don't know what you believe. How does that work for you?
Wow.
Faith in God. That is key. You can't remove the God factor.
Yeah.
For me, I can't disassociate myself from the God factor in everything I do. When people ask me things and they say, how come, how has it been? I always say to them that the God factor is key. I stay focused. I tell people, stay stubborn to your dreams.
Huh.
And that is if you also believe in it, that you are on the right path. So I stay focused to my dreams. And of course, if it's not faith, nothing will. You hear some words and then it encourages you. It keeps you going. I listened to, for me, let me tilt a bit religious. I listened a lot to Reverend Sam Adeyemi, Success Power, them days on OGBC2 and then on Ray Power and all that. And then it kept me going. And then I just had that belief in God, and had that faith, had that belief that I was definitely going somewhere. Even though I never knew where it was I was going, but I knew that I was doing the right thing and I would definitely get there. That's it for me.
Wow, faith. I think you all said it all. For me, I also believe that faith is, you know, faith is the bedrock.
Yeah.
You know, for anything you want to do in your life. I also believe that without faith, you know, you may touch a bit of what you think is success, but the faith, you know, for me, you know, is separating you from anything earthly, which kind of like gives you a reason to hold on to what is real, because what we have around us will go, we can fade away, you know, but your essence, what is you, will always remain. Okay. So I learned early enough that material things should not waver me, you know, but my faith...
They come and they go.
Yeah, my faith should be, like you said, faith to me is a foundation. And sometimes in life, you come across people who don't believe in what you believe in.
Mm.
And it's not as if you do not, you know, you can't tolerate other people, what people feel about faith.
Mm.
But in the long term, it will play out. It will play out on you. I mean, I'm a firm believer in the sense that, you know, I don't believe wealth is transferable. You know, I don't believe it. I just believe that, you know, if there's a foundation on faith, it can be transferable. Because when I reference the greats in Nigeria at times, they are great, but are their children great?
Well, that's another topic for another day. I mean, we can go on and on conclusively now. I need you guys just to talk to somebody who, a struggling man. Bills are tough. You guys have been through the rough, tough, and crazy times and have come out the way you are now. So I want you to talk to that man who needs to pay his bills. Verge of suicide, as a matter of fact. In fact, statistics has it that the rate of suicide amongst men is larger. It's higher. It's much more than the women. And mostly the reason why guys commit suicide is economic times, you know, rough times, not being able to meet up and all of that. So as we round up, I need you guys to just talk to somebody who needs to hear some encouragement from someone who has been there, done that, and actually has the t-shirt.
Let me just go. Okay, one, you either evolve or you dissolve. That's straight up. You have to evolve. By evolution, I mean change your pattern. There's a pattern for everybody. I learned to say to people, never to say I can't, but to say it is possible. So when you're face to face with people in your life who you might not even know how you may be relevant to them, try not to say I can't. Say it is possible. And also, instead of seeking help for people, ask people, how can I help you? Because you'll be surprised, you know, what you can do for people, you know, by just asking them. You know, when you come across with influential people, how can I help you, sir? How can I help you, ma? How can I be of service to you? As against, I need help.
Okay.
You know, right. I don't know if you are making any sense.
Yeah. For me, lots of young guys today. Okay, you're talking of those that got families and all.
Anyone, I mean,
okay, but lots of young guys today, they are all looking for the fast thing. This my 22nd year in this job, and then as an entertainer, so I know how it's like, and starting up and all that. But everyone wants it really fast. Whatever it is that your hand can do, you must check your inner self and then make sure that you build on it, just like Manny said, and then you evolve. You must learn to move with the times and all. A lot of us are still the way we were many years back, and then we refuse to grow, and then we complain that things are not working for us and all. And then a lot of us too, I don't want to say I blame my parents for some of those things. A lot of us don't also cultivate the culture of saving. A lot of us don't think about tomorrow. You see somebody who woke up,
impress,
whatever comes out. Yeah, whatever, yes, and then they just squander at once. and you see someone will walk up to you and tell you, I don't have money to pay for my wife's hospital bill. She just gave birth and I don't have money to pay for it. And then I wonder, when was she pregnant? Was she pregnant yesterday? She was pregnant 9 months ago.
You should have planned for
it. So you should have planned for it because you know that the baby will come someday. So why not plan for it? And then they start to give you stories and all. You know, I meet them all the time outside.
So but planning.
Then you must plan. You must plan. You stop giving those kind of excuses. And then the little time that you have, a lot of us too don't cultivate the habit of helping others, no matter how small it is.
Render
that help. No, I tell people, you walk up to me and then you say to me, okay, for example, please, I need money for, let me say just the same pregnancy thing I said now. And then the first thing I ask the person is, don't you go to church? Are you not a fellowship in your church? Don't you, don't have your own family members? You as a person, you don't have brothers, friends, and others that can help you. Your wife does not have friends, brothers, and that you've helped before that can help you. And then you, your church you go to, you don't belong to any fellowship. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah. And then in your village, you don't do village meeting, did that. So come on. So all these people, nobody agreed to help you. You must be a wicked person. No matter how small that you have, also render help.
Okay.
Stretch it out to people. And then just lastly, and then like I love to say to everyone, it is still you can't rule out the God factor. Nye said in his song Street Credibility, I'm on a turn by turn. Beg Baba God, make it reach your turn. This industry, plenty python. Anyhow it will be, stay focused on your way to the top. If you listen to Street Credibility very well. And that's the same thing I say to everyone that listens, that are listening right now.
What can I say? I wish we could go on and on, but we've got to put a plug to it right now. Thank you guys for coming. Really appreciate it.
Yes, boss.
Thank you for
my
listening.
Account number, sir. My account number. Boss.
Yeah, behind the scenes.
Behind the scenes.
Yeah. Carry on. Thank you so much for listening. We appreciate it. You can follow us on Twitter at Men's Room OJ, Facebook at Men's Room, and drop your thoughts and just stay with us. We'll catch you again same time, same dial next week with a different set of people or a different individual. I'm Onimisi Adaba, over and out.
Please click on the red subscribe button below this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel.